got a question for you. How many of you actually know the full history of Mondstadt? How many of you knew the full history of Mondstadt and then later forgot? I'm guessing that's probably most of you. As Genshin Impact's story continues to develop, we're only going to be getting more and more information, which means there's more and more things to forget about later. In light of this, I thought it would be a really good idea to create a series where we just go over the important bits. A series that helps make Genshin's lore more accessible to new players, while also providing a quick and handy way for established players to refresh their memories. So, allow me to welcome you to this brand new series I have dubbed The Beginner's Guide to Genshin Lore. Now, keep in mind, I have no intention of covering every historical incident, so this guide will by no means be comprehensive. It will, however, provide a solid foundation for further research and investigation, as I will be including no theorizing, no hypothesizing, and no speculating. I know, it's rare for me. However, I will be making a couple of assumptions which will be marked and further elaborated on in the description box below, so do make sure to check that out. Well now then, since this is the first video in the series, why don't we start by going over the history of the region where the game first started? My name is Ashikai, and this is the Beginner's Guide to Mondstadt. Our story begins over 2,600 years ago in the city of Mondstadt. We're gonna call this Old Mondstadt in order to differentiate it from New Mondstadt, which is the city that is built upon Cider Lake. Old Mondstadt was situated a little bit more to the west in what we now know as Storm Terror's Lair. Back when this was Mondstadt's capital, the whole region of Mondstadt was home to basically two gods that we know of. Decarabian, the god of storms, and Andreas, also known as the North Winds. For reasons unknown, Andreas declared war on the god of storms. This war was one of many smaller wars that would later become known collectively as the Archon War, but that's a topic for another video. Now during this time, and possibly prior to this war as well, Mondstadt was covered in snow and ice. The presence and will of Andreas brought forth blizzards that made life outside of the city of Old Mondstadt incredibly difficult. Seriously, it's like a year-round winter. I wouldn't want to live there either. Now, Decarabian actually ruled over the city of Old Mondstadt, so those were his people, and he did take responsibility for them and their safety by creating an enormous wind barrier that surrounded the whole city. This wind barrier protected his people from Andreas's blizzards, but also kinda sorta trapped them inside. Andreas could not break this wind barrier, and Decarabian refused to come out of his tower in the center of Old Mondstadt, so the battle between the two gods was never actually resolved. But as time passed, the people of Old Mondstadt became less and less pleased with their situation. They began to see Decarabian not as a god that protected them from the harsh blizzards of the outside, but as a tyrant that held them captive. Some people, however, were able to leave the city, but it's not quite clear how. The Gunnhildr clan is one of those that did manage to leave successfully, but life outside the wind barrier was harsh and incredibly difficult. Freezing, hungry, and desperate, the Gunnhildr clan built a shrine and prayed to the divine for help, but only a small wind spirit answered their call. Their faith and prayers somehow became a source of power for this little spirit, and it used this power to shelter the clan from the cold. This tiny spirit then made its way to the city of Old Mondstadt, and somehow slipped inside. Inside the city, it met a boy known only to us as the Nameless Bard. The Nameless Bard and the spirit became very close friends. Eventually, the Nameless Bard would tell the spirit about his dream of seeing the world outside the city and the birds flying free in the sky, and how that dream could never come true unless the tyrant, Decarabian, fell. Now, it was this dream, along with the general civil unrest of the people who were being oppressed within the city, that inevitably sparked the beginnings of a rebellion against the God of Storms. The Nameless Bard led this charge with the help of the Wind Spirit, a knight from the Gunnhildr clan, a red-headed knight that was likely the beginnings of the Ragnvindr family, so Deluxe family, as well as a woman named Amos, who was apparently Decarabian's mortal lover. Yeah, I don't quite follow that one either. the rebellion was successful and Decarabian was overthrown. It's not quite clear whether he's dead or sealed, but regardless, the battle did not end without some casualties. Amos was among the many who were killed, as well as the nameless bard, whose dream of seeing the world outside the wind barrier would go unfulfilled. And with Decarabian defeated, the wind spirit and Andreas were the only two remaining gods in Mondstadt that we know of. But Andreas did not fight the wind spirit. I guess he didn't have a grudge against him like he did Decarabian. It's really not that clear. But apparently he somehow realized that his powers only brought harm to humans and he therefore could not care for them properly, which is also a little bit weird because it's not quite clear that he liked them to begin with, but suspend your disbelief. Regardless, he then gave up his physical form and let his power seep into the land of Mondstadt, leaving the wind spirit as the last god standing. Well, with a physical form at least, because Andreas kind of became like this weird ghost wolf that we fight every week. So he's still like kind of here in a ghost form, but he doesn't really have like a physical body, so he's not like a full god. I don't know, it's weird, it's complicated, just roll with it. Anyway, the wind spirit then borrowed the form of his dearly departed friend, the nameless bard, and thus became Barbados, or Venti, the Anemo Archon. What remained of Andreas became one of the four winds that would assist Barbados in protecting Mondstadt for years to come. Andreas essentially became the Wolf of the North. Now, the newly born Archon used his powers to blow away all of the ice and snow that covered the land until all that was left was a very lush green paradise that we see there now. His winds cut gouges into the earth and split mountains, while the melted snow caused the sea levels to rise at least a little bit. Not long after this terraforming, the people of Old Mondstadt abandoned their city and built a new one atop an island in Cider Lake. Barbados officially became their god, and they declared to uphold his dream or ideal of freedom. Now, roughly around this time, while the city was being built, I guess? The timeline's a little bit muddy. But around this time, Dvalin was born from the pure animal energy that kind of accumulated in a big mass in the heavens somewhere. Newly born and curious about the world, he wandered into New Mondstadt and probably frightened the people there until Barbados magically appeared. Up until this point, dragons were considered monsters and not really, you know, beings that humans get along with, so Barbados, being the enigma that he is, kind of did the unthinkable and managed to befriend the dragon. He then declared him one of the four winds and tasked him with the protection of Mondstadt. Dvalin became known as the Dragon of the East, just as Andreas became the Wolf of the North. And with all the crises averted and a strong city freshly established, Barbados decided that there was nothing left to do but let his people enjoy their cherished freedom. So he left Mondstadt in the care of the current ruling class, which was then made up of three clans, the Lawrence, the Grunhilder, and the Emanlocker. Barbados then trusted them to work together to uphold his ideal of freedom and to never let the people fall prey to tyranny ever again. But politics is as politics does, and the powers of the clans were very unbalanced. The Lawrence clan soon took center stage and all of the power, and soon followed in Decarabian's footsteps, seeking to control the people rather than to promote freedom. The Order of the Knights at the time, the Starlit Knights, and the Church at the time, supported the aristocratic rule of the Lawrence clan, and they just aided them in keeping the people ignorant and subservient. So, good job. No one's really sure what happened to the Emanlocker clan, but the Grunhilder clan appeared to be the only noble clan left in Mondstadt that actually opposed the rule of the Lawrence clan, but they lacked the power and influence to properly challenge them, so they were a little bit useless. Many years passed before a nomadic tribe from Natlin was found and captured elsewhere in Mondstadt after being relentlessly terrorized by a monster known only as Ursa the Drake. Among this tribe was a girl known as Vanessa. Her people were then turned into slaves in Mondstadt, so she decided to become a gladiator in order to win their freedom. Now, around this time, Barbados decided to check in to Mondstadt, and what he found did not make him very happy. The nation of freedom that he sought to build was nowhere to be found. Instead, he basically found a repeat of the city of Decarabian, but, you know, 2.0, brand new, yeah. And just as he met the nameless bard, he met and befriended Vanessa and offered her help, which she then, you know, refused. She claimed that her problems were hers to solve, which is, you know, pretty respectable, but also, come on, it's okay to ask for help. And help she did need, because Vanessa was headstrong and very, very stubborn, and somehow she managed to anger the current heir of the Lawrence clan. The Lawrence clan then decided to make a deal with Ursa the Drake. In exchange for leaving Mondstadt alone, the Lawrence clan would give Ursa, Vanessa, and all of the people of her tribe. Anyway, as part of her punishment for pissing off the Lawrence clan, Vanessa was then thrown into the gladiator arena and forced to fight in a series of grueling battles. When she did finally reach the last opponent, she was faced with none other than Ursa the Drake himself. Before she could even think about properly preparing herself to fight the monster that once hunted her people down in the wilds of Mondstadt for many, many years, her entire tribe was then thrown into the arena as well, with no means of defending themselves. The odds were completely stacked against them, but Vanessa refused to give up. And her bravery impressed Barbados so much that he descended upon the arena and granted Vanessa just enough power to defeat Ursa for good. Vanessa's victory over Ursa the Drake and her blessing from the animal Archon won her the heart of the common people. Together with notable figures like the Ragenbinder clan, again, Deluc's family, Cruislead, we're not going to talk about him, and a dissident faction of the church, she was able to lead a successful rebellion, exiling all but a few noble clans that remained uncorrupted, but still kind of useless, like the Gunhilders, which would be Jean's family. Vanessa then established the Knights of Favonius and became one of the Four Winds of Barbados, the Lion of the South. We also know this wind as the Lionfang Knight or the Dandelion Knight. This title would then continue to be inherited by members of the Knights of Favonius as time went on. And this ushered in the beginning of Mondstadt's era of true freedom. And finally certain that his ideals would be upheld this time, Barbados vanished once again. After her death, Vanessa ascended to Celestia and became our only confirmed mortal to do so. We do have others that we think ascended, but we can't actually confirm them. But anyway, she emerged from Celestia in the form of a falcon. Then likely becoming the final of the Four Winds, the Falcon of the West. And she still looks over Mondstadt to this day. Roughly 500 years later, which would also be 500 years ago from the current point in the game, monsters from the abyss started to appear all over Teyvat, causing destruction and devastation wherever they went. And if you've ever fought the Rifthounds, you'll understand why this was problematic. The Knights of Favonius mobilized, led by Grandmaster Arundelin, and another knight by the name of Rostam. They led an expedition into Conria, the supposed source of the monster infestation. But Rostam died during this expedition, and his lover, Rosalyn, learned of his death upon her return to Mondstadt from her study abroad in Sumeru, and she didn't take it very well. She flew into a violent rage and used her studies from the Sumeru Academia to turn herself into the Crimson Witch of Flames. She fought the abyssal infestation herself until her life all but burned away completely. Her dying body was later found and then revived by the Fatui, somehow or other. We're not quite sure how, just roll with it. They bestowed upon her a cryo delusion, which calmed the raging flames inside of her and let her function normally. She then assumed the name of Senora and became the eighth of the Fatui Harbingers, never forgetting her grudge against the animal Archon. Because, you know, he didn't actually help her or her lover when they needed him most. But it wasn't for lack of trying. See, during the Cataclysm, Barbados was otherwise occupied by an even greater foe than the swarms of monsters and rifthounds that people were fighting. Durin, a great abyssal dragon, had descended upon Mondstadt, and there was no one able to fight him except the animal Archon himself. Barbados enlisted the help of Dvalin, and together they managed to take down Durin and trap him inside of Dragonspine, which we will talk about in another video. But this feat was not accomplished without its own set of casualties. Dvalin, having ingested Durin's toxic blood during the battle, flew back to Old Mondstadt, where he fell into a deep, deep sleep in order to recover. Barbados also vanished around this time. Not really sure why, but likely to follow Dvalin's lead and to also sleep and recover his powers, because it apparently took a lot out of him. But what happened to Conria itself and the monsters that surged from it remains a bit of a mystery, although it's safe to say that the heavenly principles were involved, at least somewhat. But with the monsters quelled, Mondstadt fell into a period of relative peace. Until one day, Dvalin woke, not of his own volition, but at the behest of the Abyss Order, former citizens of Conria, hell-bent on revenge against Celestia for the destruction of their nation. They manipulated Dvalin in his weakened state, and kind of convinced him to just terrorize Mondstadt. And that is where the story of Genshin Impact began. And that's it. That's Mondstadt's history in a nutshell. I mean, there's still a lot I haven't covered, but half the fun of learning about lore and history isn't being told what happened, but discovering it for yourself. So go forth, learn, explore, read. Please, please read. And of course, let me know what you found. I hope you enjoyed this Beginner's Guide to Genshin Lore Mondstadt Edition, and I hope you'll stick with me for the rest of the series. Until then, take care, guys, and I'll catch you in the next video. Bye-bye.